Good morning. All right. Our Old Testament reading this morning is Psalm 72. And we are in the book of Acts, the first few verses of the book of Acts this morning. I thought it would be nice, as we have been looking at things in 1st and 2nd Kings, then to take a bit of a break there. I know we had a little break for Easter and the resurrection, but now we're going to do it again and look at what comes after that, what comes after the resurrection. So just to keep these things fresh in our minds. So we're looking at Psalm 72 here as our Old Testament reading. And this psalm ends the book two of the Psalter. There's five books in the Psalter. This ends book two, and it's the only one that says it's Psalm of Solomon, but it describes the king and God and a government, if you will, that is faithful to God, that is doing God's will, that is enacting and carrying out justice for the afflicted, for the poor, the needy, and the vulnerable of life. And in pursuing that role and being faithful to God in carrying out these things, then we see even the land itself responds with fruitfulness. And you'll see that through these verses. But this is a picture then of the kingdom of God in its fullness as to come. So Psalm 72, give the king your judgments, O God, and your righteousness to the king's son. May he judge your people with righteousness and your afflicted with justice. Let the mountains bring peace to the people and the hills in righteousness. May he vindicate the afflicted of the people, save the children of the needy, and crush the oppressor. Let them fear you while the sun endures and as long as the moon throughout all generations. May he come down like rain upon the mown grass, like showers that water the earth. In his days may the righteous flourish and abundance of peace till the moon is no more. May he also rule from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. Let the nomads of the desert bow before him and his enemies lick the dust. Let the kings of Tarshish and of the islands bring presents. The kings of Sheba and Seba offer gifts. And let all kings bow down before him. All nations serve him. For he will deliver the needy when he cries for help, the afflicted also, and him who has no helper. He will have compassion on the poor and needy, and the lives of the needy he will save. He will rescue their life from oppression and violence, and their blood will be precious in his sight. So may he live, and may the gold of Sheba be given to him, and let them pray for him continually. Let them bless him all day long. May there be abundance of grain in the earth on top of the mountains. Its fruit will wave like the cedars of Lebanon, and may those from the city flourish like vegetation of the earth. May his name endure forever. May his name increase as long as the sun shines. And let men bless themselves by him. Let all nations call him blessed. Blessed be the Lord God, the God of Israel, who alone works wonders. And blessed be his glorious name forever. And may the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and amen. The prayers of David, the son of Jesse, are ended. So here ends the reading of God's word. Okay. We come now to a confession of faith. I have here the Nicene Creed, which is 138 in the hymnal. So we'll confess this together. And this is about the triune God, and it's particularly about the second person of the Trinity, the Son, and who he is. And so, and that's what came about at the Council of Nicaea, was how we understand the Son in relationship to the Father and to the Holy Spirit. So we'll do this, and I will ask you, or I'll talk about this later, but think about these creeds. As we've done the Apostles' Creed, we're doing the Nicene Creed, but think about what they don't contain as you recite this confession of faith as we do it together. So let's stand, if able to do this, and we'll confess these things together. Christian, what do you believe? I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one universal and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. We come now to our time of prayer. It is a prayer of confession of sin and the seeking of assurance of pardon. It's also intercessory, and we'll pray for those who are on our hearts and minds today. But I'll give you a moment, as is our practice, to pray silently, and then I'll lead us in prayer, and we will close together today with the Lord's Prayer. So let us pray. Our Father and our God, as we continue in your grace, we discover in you our refuge, a place that we may hide ourselves, that we may never be ashamed. In your righteousness you deliver and you rescue, and you have inclined your ear to us. Father, as we come today, we pray that you hear us. You, who are the creator, the sustainer, and the redeemer of life, above all, that you would be pleased to hear your people as we come to you, to talk to you, to seek your face, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins against you. Father, we pray that you hear and answer. Forgive us the ways we have failed to serve you, failed to be good representatives of your name. Father, we ask that you forgive us in the ways in which we have failed to serve one another, failed to love one another as we have been loved, to love our wives, our husbands, our kids, our moms, our dads, all of these relationships in which we find ourselves as co-workers, as neighbors. Father, we ask that you forgive us in these things and that you strengthen us to go forward, to be who you call us to be. Father, we thank you that through Jesus Christ, who has given his life, who has come in your name to rescue his people from their sins, that by your grace we may find ourselves in that category, those that he has delivered. Help us to conform our lives to the image in which we have been made and are now being renewed. And we pray, O Lord, that we would understand what that means, that kind of forgiveness and the freedom that comes with it, to not be afraid of the truth. To not be afraid of the world, knowing that you are in us and greater than the world. Help us to understand these things, that we might be faithful witnesses, that we might know that we are yours and you are ours, and that you are with us no matter where we go and what we do. Help us to speak to this world on your behalf, to reflect you, Father. We pray not only for the forgiveness of our sin and the seeking of assurance that we are yours and you are ours, but we pray for those who are on our hearts and minds today. We have so many on our list, and you know them as we mention them week to week. You know them far greater than we do, and you know their needs. And so we continue to commit them to your merciful hands, that you would see their pain, their struggles, their doubts, their fears, all of these things that would weigh upon them, things that even weigh upon us. But we pray that you would be with them, that you would continue to work in their lives, opening their hearts and minds to your love and your grace and your mercy, that you would bring healing to their bodies, to their minds, to their hearts. Pray for Barb and Linda and Carol and Gwen, Iris and Susie and Nora and June and John and Brenda and Ron and Kathy and Rosemarie, Wilda and Elaine and Mary. Pray for Roy and Janice and Forrest. We pray for so many, those even that go unmentioned today and yet are in the very hearts and minds of your people even now. We lift them up to you, commit them to your hands, that you would take all of these things into your hands and bring to us comfort and peace, knowing that we are yours in Jesus Christ, what it means to be in union with him, to have that organic relationship connected to him as a lifeline. Father, we pray that for each one. And we pray for the congregations in this area who lift up your name, who seek to worship you this morning, that you would be with them, that you would strengthen and encourage them, that they would know you are with them. Pray that for each congregation in this area, this state, and around this country and world, that your people would know your presence this morning and rejoice and do the thing, the very most important thing in life itself, and that is to worship you. So, Father, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, that great kingdom prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and glory forever. Amen.
Hymn number 240, Fairest Lord Jesus.
Okay, it's time for the young people's message. Young people's message. Okay, young people. All right. I had some fun with this one, trying to figure out a treat. That'll come later. Now, what is a witness? What is a witness? What do you think of when you hear the word witness? A witness is one who sees or has personal experience of an event. That's one sense of witness. When we talk about the meaning of witness, it is often to do with a court case, huh? Like a trial. Do you think of that? A trial? Now, there are other things. We'll talk about them in a minute. But someone who testifies in court, you know, they're called to give testimony. That is what we often think of as a witness. At least that's what I think of. I don't know what you're thinking. Maybe you're thinking chicken nuggets. No, that's from last week. Sorry. I just wanted to bring that up. Sorry. All right. No, but when you think of witness, you think of someone who testifies, someone in court. But what does it mean to testify then? What does it mean to testify? Again, it's something we think of as a witness. It means to be a witness, but it can mean to serve as evidence or proof of the existence of a truth or a matter, the truth of a matter or the truth of a thing. It means, you know, as a witness, when you testify, you yourself serve as evidence that something has taken place or the truth of a matter. So to be a witness is to testify to the existence of the truth of something you have seen or experienced. Have you ever been a witness? Have you ever been a witness? It doesn't have to be in a court case, right? You can be a witness of something that takes place at home or in school or maybe in a car. Maybe you see something, an accident, something like that. Sometimes we're witnesses just because of where we are at a particular point in time. Other times we can be appointed as witnesses. Some people have a job that solely is about being a witness. In fact, I had to go to a notary yesterday, and those people serve as witnesses. They testify to things. Other times there are events where we may be asked to be a witness. Can you think of an event where you may be asked to be a witness? Or by your very presence, you are a witness. Sometimes it involves being invited to a wedding, perhaps. When you are invited to a wedding, you come and they're saying, we want you to be a witness to what is taking place, right? We are invited to a wedding in order to witness the joining of this man and this woman, that kind of thing, right? Our text this morning mentions witnesses. So we're going to talk about witnesses. And I want you to think then, as you listen to the text and the message, who are the witnesses and what will they be witnessing or testifying about? So I want you to think about that. And then, of course, what is this treat? What would be the treat for this kind of thing? Well, this might be a stretch. When you witness something, you often see it. So you roll your eyes over it. And so I just thought, well, that's a Rollo. Okay, so think about that witness testimony. That is a stretch, I know. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for these young hearts and young minds. And we pray for them as they grow in their understanding of who you are, as they read your word and discover what you have done in your word, not only that which they see in nature and your world created, that general revelation, but they also see in that special revelation, your word, the things you have accomplished. And how they are explained there makes them to become witnesses of your grace, your holiness, your justice, your power, your majesty, all of these things. And we pray that they grow in that they become faithful witnesses of it. We pray that not only for them, but for each one of us. And we ask it to the glory of Christ. Amen. Okay, so we're looking at the book of Acts. We had gone through Acts some time ago, but I thought it would be good to revisit. Chapter 1, we're going to look at these opening verses. Chapter 1, verses 1 to 8. So a short passage here. Short passage. Book of Acts. Chapter 1, verses 1 to 8. Hear God's word. Again, I'm reading from the New American Standard. And so if you have any questions, if your translation's different, we can certainly talk about it. Open to all that stuff. So hear God's word. The first account I composed, Theophilus, about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after he had, by the Holy Spirit, given orders to the apostles whom he had chosen. To these he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over a period of 40 days and speaking of the things concerning the kingdom of God. Gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the Father had promised, which, he said, you heard of from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they were asking him, saying, Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know times or epochs which the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and even to the remotest part of the earth. Here ends the reading of God's word. So we've said this before, and say it again just as a reminder, that the greatest power and authority of this world, the greatest power and authority that this world holds over any individual, whether it's by government or otherwise, by terror, is death. That is the greatest power that this world holds. The reality of Jesus' resurrection, the event at the center of history, that reality changes everything. And so the book of Acts is an historical account, a biblical account, of what Jesus' resurrection means and how it changes the world going forward. It is the second volume of Luke's work, the follow-on to his gospel, and Luke's purpose is found in the prologue of his gospel. So we can reflect on that as well as when we look at this second volume. But his prologue talks about the idea that he was to write an orderly account of the things that have taken place according to the eyewitnesses and ministers of the word, so that you, and he's talking to Theophilus, most excellent Theophilus, so that you, and therefore when he talks to him, he's talking to us as readers, that you may know the truth concerning the things of which you have been informed. This is his purpose, and this is his purpose for this second volume as well. The disciples are about to face the world, a world hostile to their message and mission, and so as we look at these opening verses and think about what difference does Jesus' resurrection make? The one thing I want you to take away today is this. Jesus' strategy for renewing the world, that is bringing his kingdom on earth, excuse me, is the witness of his disciples through the power of the Spirit. Sorry, I'm just going to grab this water because I know I'm going to need it. Jesus' strategy for renewing the world, that is bringing his kingdom on earth, is the witness of his disciples and even you through the power and agency of the Holy Spirit. So our context, as we said, this is Luke's gospel was the first volume, all that Jesus began to do and teach, and now we're moving into the second volume, the results of that. What's the outworking now of the resurrection of Christ? The creeds, you know, I mentioned the creeds. We recited here the Nicene Creed, and we often recite the Apostles' Creed. But what are the things that are not mentioned in the creeds? You know, we kind of go from he comes, right, born of the Virgin Mary. And what does it go to? It goes right immediately to suffered under Pontius Pilate, doesn't it? There's not much mention of what he did in life as he came and why he came. But the Gospels fill that in for us. The Gospels teach us about Jesus fulfilling the Word of God, fulfilling the promises to Abraham, fulfilling Israel's story, and bringing that story to a climax, if you will. We'll talk more about that. But the placement of Acts, the book of Acts, in the canon of Scripture, we have the four Gospels, and then we have Acts, and then the Pauline, and what's called the Catholic Epistles. So we have the Gospels themselves that tell us about all that Jesus began to do and teach, and then we have the book of Acts, which then connect those Gospels to the letters, okay? And Acts does that, connects those letters, Paul's letters, John's letters, Peter's, all of these things. And so this is the function of the book of Acts. So we're going to look now at these opening verses. So we'll take them just a couple at a time. First, verses 1 and 2. And this is Luke's sequel, Luke's second volume. Luke is not one of the 12, but he is a companion of the Apostle Paul. He's well-educated, he's a Greek, and a physician. A church historian, Eusebius, tells us that Luke was from Antioch of Syria, where the followers of Jesus were first called Christians. Both Luke's gospel and the book of Acts are well-researched and of the highest literary quality. We know early 20th century Scottish archaeologist, foremost authority of his day on the history of Asia Minor, Sir William Mitchell Ramsay, noted this. Luke is a historian of the first rank. Not merely are his statements of fact trustworthy, he should be placed along with the very greatest of historians. And that's really what happens. Even when you read Luke's gospel, the opening of that gospel is like throwing down the gauntlet to say to everyone who's about to read, I want you to test these things. These are written as historical facts, eyewitness accounts. Now, he was not an eyewitness, but he had access to the eyewitness accounts. He will eyewitness some of the events later, as we know, as Paul's traveling companion. But he had access to the eyewitness accounts, and he writes in a manner that is historically accurate and historically a document of substance. So now, Acts' genre is then historiography. Luke selected and organized his material to reflect his theological and pastoral purposes. Luke recounts historical events in this way to give meaning to the church's mission and God's redemptive plan, of course, for Israel and the world. And we're going to see that right at the start here. N.T. Wright notes that Acts of Jesus, so when we think, we often refer to it as the book of Acts. But what does that mean, the book of Acts? Acts of what? Acts of who? And so It's often referred to as the Acts of the Apostles. In other words, they're going to carry out or carry on the mission of Jesus. But sometimes it's the Acts of Jesus where we think Jesus is the one who is behind all of this. And there's another where we say it's the Acts of the Holy Spirit, because it is actually through the agency of the Holy Spirit that the disciples go forward or the apostles go forward and teach and proclaim the kingdom of God. So there, you know, when you think of the book of Acts, it could be a number of ways about thinking of it. So, but Wright notes, I think here, what Jesus does, we don't see a lot of Jesus, a few cameos, but he's always there, kind of just off stage. In other words, we do see things where, like Paul's conversion and so forth. So Jesus is there, not center stage, but off stage and seemingly always present. Acts of the Apostles, 12 are chosen. There's now 11, and there will be a replacement of Judas Iscariot. And like the tribes of old Israel, the 12 represent the new Israel, now redefined around Jesus. And we're going to talk more about that as we look at some of these verses here later, this idea. I want you to keep that in mind. There's a pattern here, right? We had the 12 tribes and the 12 sons, and then we have the 12 apostles. We lose Judas Iscariot as the one who betrays, but they're going to fill that role again. So there'll be 12. And this is kind of the new Israel centered around Jesus of Nazareth. So the when we think of the Acts of the Holy Spirit, this is the promise of the Father, the power of new creation. And so this is what the opening is talking about. Then we come to verses 3-5. The basis for the mission ahead is twofold. Jesus is alive and the power of the Spirit in proclaiming the kingdom. The basis for the mission is both that Jesus is alive and resurrected, living, and the power of the Spirit is given. So filling in the time period here between the resurrection and what's taking place now, there are 40 days that Jesus appeared to the apostles. And he appears with what's called convincing truths or convincing proofs, proofs of his resurrection. And that word here for convincing means plain, that these things are plain to the eye, plain, clear to see, something that removes all doubt. Might use the word indubitable, unquestionable evidence. The apostles and new work need to tell the world there is a new king, and this is Jesus. This is the counter narrative to the world. Death does not have the last word. Jesus is alive, the first fruits of the resurrection. And this is, as we have mentioned before, what separates Christianity from all other religions. The one who comes to believe in the resurrected Christ, even the smallest of ways, is no longer bound by the conventions of a world that predicates everything on death. The strength behind this work, the reason it will not fail, of course, is the Holy Spirit, both his presence and his power. The role of the Spirit has been in the background, and we see here that he is working even when Jesus is giving his apostles the orders, the commands, and how to do these things. And so, yet, the Spirit is coming in a fuller way. We'll find out more about this. What I'm planning to do is to talk about, you know, when we come to Pentecost, we'll talk about Pentecost here in the book of Acts. We'll preach on that later this month. But just like John the Baptist prepared the way for the king, so the Holy Spirit will come in power and new creation, renewing humanity and renewing the world. Christ's kingdom of forgiveness and resurrection will go forward in the power of the Holy Spirit, but through the proclamation, the declaration, the witnessing of Jesus's apostles. So Jesus commands them to stay together and to wait in Jerusalem. This is going to begin in Jerusalem. So Jesus' strategy then is to renew the world through them. It says, they say, that the apostles at this time meeting with Jesus say, Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom to Israel? We know the struggles they had. We remember on the way to Jerusalem before the crucifixion, before the Passover, Jesus had told his disciples three times what was to take place. And they struggled with it. And they struggled with it even up to the point that it took place. And they abandoned him, which was the plan of God, as we know. So there was a struggle with, you know, are we going to be in the kingdom the way we think of kingdom, that we're going to sit on your right and your left, and this is going to be great because Rome is going to be squashed and all of this. It's a sense of nationalism. But is this still the case now that they've come through the death and resurrection? And there's been 40 days of Jesus teaching them these things. As the resurrected Christ, they have seen him with convincing proofs. Were the disciples still thinking along the lines of Jesus being king in Jerusalem like a David or Solomon was king? Is there still a sense of nationalism? Not that of the failed stewardship, but of their own, perhaps. Maybe they're still thinking this way. Maybe they still have these ambitions. Certainly they have been turned to be different from that of the failed stewardship. They've watched what's taken place, and they've seen the resurrection. So what are they thinking? Were they thinking fulfillment of Scripture like Psalm 72 or Psalm 89 or even Isaiah and the servant of Isaiah? Or Jeremiah. Jesus had told them three times he would die in Jerusalem and rise again. They're on the other side of this now. And so is it now that their dreams of kingdom come true? Jesus' response here is twofold. We see that there is a no and a yes. A no and a yes component. No, not in the way they expect, but yes, and they will be at the heart of it. The caution here is to read Jesus' response as a complete no to the idea of the kingdom coming on earth as it is in heaven. We shouldn't read that. We know from Luke's first volume and the other Gospels that Jesus' kingdom had begun. And yet there is a fuller reality of it yet to come at some point here in the future. But they were not to know and therefore refrain from predicting the times or epochs of that fulfillment. But the work of the kingdom is at hand. The restoration is in process. In the ancient world, when there was a regime change, you know, a new king has come to power, witnesses were sent out. They didn't have the internet. I know that might surprise you. They didn't have the web, but they had messengers that when a new king took over, they would send messengers out to all the districts, all the areas to say, hey, there's a new king. And so that is perhaps a pattern that we have in view in terms of what's going on, in terms of fulfillment. There is also, though, I think maybe a little more stronger in the sense of a biblical argument here is the idea that this is a new Israel and it is fulfilling its mission of blessing the nations. And that was Israel's role all along. Even with when we look at Isaiah, when Isaiah prophesies about the servant, some of you are familiar with, you may be familiar with the servant songs in Isaiah. And so when Isaiah talks about those things, when he talks about the servants, when he describes what God is going to do, God himself calls Israel his witnesses. He says, you will be my witnesses. This is what's going on, I think. Here what we see is Israel as called by God through Abraham. God was gave promises to Abraham that he would bless them, but also that they in turn would be a blessing to the nations. That was to be the role of Israel. Israel, we know, failed in that role, at least to this point. And what we see in Jesus as the true Israel, now centered on him, he is called 12, right? And now he is going to send them out, and they are going to go to the nations. It's now that Israel is set in the right way, in the right role, with the right king, and now they are going to go out and be what they were always intended to be, that they were going to communicate God. They're going to be witnesses of God and his king and kingdom to the world. That's how the blessing will come. That's what is taking place here. It says that you will be my witnesses. In terms of fulfillment, there is a new Israel, and it is fulfilling its mission of blessing the nations. That is its intended role. You can see that in Isaiah 43 and 44 and 49. Through his death, resurrection, and soon to be ascension, Jesus has received the kingdom. We know that from Daniel 7 and the Son of Man. He is enthroned and all authority given. This is the good news. A new king is on the throne. It's the king of Israel and the king of the world. So even though they're not to know when the Father will bring the world visibly, clearly, and completely under the just and healing rule of God, they are to be at work in that restoration through the proclamation of his kingship, of his authority, of his forgiveness, of his healing, his resurrection. All of these things, this is their mission. So they now carry the message of eternal life into a world that cannot and will not think beyond death. This is their mission. And Jesus told his disciples, essentially, you have work to do. You will be given power, and you will be my witnesses. Verse 8, then, as we conclude, is the thought of, verse 8 is thought of as a roadmap, kind of an outline of the book of Acts. It's going to begin in Jerusalem, it will go to Judea, Samaria, and the remotest parts of the earth. This is the picture. This was the picture intended all along, even from the garden. Okay, it's going to go out. The kingdom is going to go out. It's going to cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. That's what's going to happen. And this is basically what verse 8 is saying. This is how it's going to progress. And when we get to Acts chapter 28, now it says, now Paul stayed 2 full years in his own rented lodging. Where is he? He is in Rome. Okay, so it's gone out. And Paul's in Rome, and it said he welcomed all who came to him, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching things about the Lord Jesus Christ with all openness, unhindered. And we know he was arrested, but he's allowed to do that, to teach those things. So, at this point in the book of Acts, we don't even know who Saul of Tarsus or Paul is, but this is where we end up. And so the kingdom of God is proclaimed. That is, that Jesus Christ is raised from the dead and living, and in him is the forgiveness of sins and the renewal of all humanity. So a few points of application. I close. Recently, we've been looking at Elijah and Elisha, and we noted the transition between the two. The two were separated by the power of God. Elijah is taken in a moment, and we know there wasn't a whole lot of time there, and it was a little bit of an awkward transition, right? Elisha wants to stay with Elijah. Elijah says, stay here, don't come with me, and then it's this whole back and forth thing, and yet we know that what was taking place in that transition was the spirit of Elijah was given to Elisha, and Elisha was to carry on the work of Elijah. So Elisha carries on the work of Elijah, but the transition is abrupt. without much warning or much dialogue. But what a difference it is with Christ. Now, we know this as the dying and rising Messiah. Jesus' departure is significantly different. I mean, you can think of a number of things, right? Elijah doesn't know death, but Jesus does taste death and comes through the other side, is resurrected in the glory. Jesus is the Son of David and the King, and so forth. All of these differences. And then we note the departure itself. He spends a lot of time with his disciples, and he teaches them about the kingdom of God and how things will go. So appearing to his disciples over a 40-day period, continuing to teach them about the kingdom. His disciples will carry on the work he has started, and he has promised them the gift of the Spirit. And they will witness, they will declare, they will proclaim his kingship and his kingdom. To think about the world in a new way. Death no longer has a hold. The reality of resurrection has come, and there is life beyond the grave. This same work continues today through the power of the Spirit given to his disciples and then given to you. Now, we're not the 12 apostles. We're not in that role. They served a particular purpose for a particular reason at a particular time. But they hold that special place. We are the fruit of their labors, and we continue their mission, Christ's mission, that his glory cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. That was Jesus' strategy and is his strategy for renewing the world. It is about bringing his kingdom on earth through the witness of his disciples in and through and with the power of the Holy Spirit. So, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for this time together. We thank you for your word that teaches us about your great plan of redemption, about how it is coming to pass, and the encouragement we have when we look at human history and we see at the center of that human history is the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the first fruits of new life, of new humanity, a true Israel that is going out and bringing your word, your truth, your holiness, your love, your mercy, your grace, all of these things to a world of darkness and death. But we have the word of life, the word of your power that overcomes, and we are your people. And we pray that you sustain us in that mission. We give you praise and adoration in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Those that are willing and able, please stand for our closing hymn. It's found in the hymnal 228, I Will Sing of My Redeemer.
Thank you.
People of God, receive the blessing that comes from our God. May the boundless love and mercy of God and the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in the ever-abiding presence and power of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.